so hopefully I'm going to learn something. I get most of my best ideas from younger generations. So if I can share whatever I've cultivated in my own life experience and my own imagination and give it back, that's hopefully what I can accomplish here. And then also I want to learn something too.
And it was so exciting. We had close to 500 students here welcoming Nicolas Cage to share with them his journey as an actor.
He wanted to engage with students. He told me that backstage in the green room. He said, I want to learn from you folks as much as the students are going to learn from me.
My favorite part was his interaction with the students, because he called himself a student as well.
Something that we definitely learned was more insight of what an actor would want out of their director.
It was an interesting experience. He gave a lot of insight on the industry, his thoughts on stuff that he worked on.
It was just highly engaging and really a great event overall.
Nick fucking
to treat me like a fool, treat me mean and cruel, but love me, break my faithful heart, tear it all apart, but love me.
Won't you love me?
Will I ever, you ever go?
Ladies and gentlemen, Nicolas Cage.
A couple things before I start. I'm very happy to be sitting with your esteemed professor, because I love talking about movies, and like you, he really knows cinema. But I wanted to say that we're all students, especially me. This isn't only for you, this is for me, because I keep the student's mind with me wherever I go, and I'm hoping that we can have an exchange, and I'm going to learn something too. So the only thing I ask is, when you do ask me questions, you give me one question I can ask whoever asked the question, so I can learn something too. It's probably going to be the same question, so you'll have time to think about your answer, but that's what I wanted to say.
Before we get started, Dick, we want to share the trailer for your latest film, Renfield, which is premiering March 30th at the Overlook Film Festival in New Orleans.
That's right.
Sorry to interrupt.
Are you okay?
I need to get out. of a toxic relationship.
Why don't you start by telling us what brought you here?
My boss, he's different.
You can't get him out of your head.
No.
I need your assistance.
I'm coming, Master! Oh, you feel like he could destroy you with the snap of his fingers.
Wouldn't even need to snap.
Okay.
Uh-huh, that sounds familiar.
Yeah, what?
Renfield, bring me innocent victims. I want a handful of nuns, a busload of cheerleaders.
And I just want a normal life again. But this modern world is a dangerous place.
Thank you. You saved my life. Did I watch you cut a guy with a decorative serving platter?
It's all in the wrist.
Let me explain.
My boss gave me this power. In return, I tend to his needs, including care, feeding.
You bring him people to eat? You're like the guy that gets the villain's Postmates.
But if you were to stop focusing on his needs, what would happen?
He won't grow to full power.
Exactly. He won't grow to full power. What? That's so weird. Why would you phrase it like that? But yes. Hi. Are you here for the meeting? Well, come on.
No! Oh, no!
Some call me the Dark One. Others, the Lord of Death. To most, I am Dracula.
Okay. Obviously, we're dealing with a little bit more than just narcissism here.
Now, let's eat.
Okay, Nick, we see you. Dracula. I was going to ask you what attracted you to this film, but I think we know the answer. A lot of people don't know this, but Mel Brooks produced David Lynch's The Elephant Man, which is a very odd pairing. And when the late, great John Hurt first walked onto the set in full makeup, as John Merrick, he was terrified. He said, and I paraphrase, if just one person had laughed, the whole film would have been ruined. That's the kind of weight that comes with certain characters, and Dracula is certainly one of them. So what was it like first walking onto the set in full makeup? And was the weight of getting Dracula right at times unbearable?
You said a lot of very interesting things right there, and because I know David Lynch, first and foremost, and I remember he said to me once, John Hurt kept singing Nowhere Man on the set of The Elephant Man from the Beatles, and I think he meant it as an insult, and I said, well, maybe he was just singing the song because he liked the song, but David was pretty sensitive about that. So that just comes to mind immediately. But getting back to Dracula, yes, you are right. Dracula is a character that has an enormous legacy, both in literature and in cinema. Dracula is a character that has been done well many times, and it has been done poorly many times. And so what I wanted to do naturally was be on the side of doing something well. And so what that meant was looking at all the great performances of Dracula, Langella, Oldman, and Bela Lugosi. And then I centered on Christopher Lee, who was pretty much my Dracula from the old Hammer horror films. And I thought, well, that's the look I want to have, with the slick back kind of 60s hairdo. But then I had a great makeup artist named Christian Tinsley, who is also thinking about bringing some of the Lon Chaney London After Midnight look with the big fangs. So I had these ceramic fangs that I was always were always in my mouth. So I had to practice my dialogue in my hotel room, trying to get the sound to come out in an articulate and elegant manner, because Dracula is a very elegant character. getting into the psyche of Dracula is something that was not explored as much in this movie, because as you can tell from the trailer, this is really Nick Holt's movie. I was there supporting him. And what he did in that movie is quite remarkable, because usually when we see Renfield portrayed, we see him as a grotesque character. Nick is a very charming, witty, handsome guy. So it's a brand new take on Renfield. That alone is exciting about the movie. But what I was trying to do was, we had a few screen tests, and I just had to take ownership of the character and sort of enter the room, so I felt I had command. Dracula has great command of any room that he walks into, and that was a good exercise. They didn't have the sound rolling, but I'm just running off the dialogue and getting comfortable with the crew and with the director before we've actually started principal photography. So I had that. I had the screen test time to sort out the wardrobe, great costume director on that, makeup, and then my own moves. So I became comfortable with the director and the camera as the character. But I knew where I wanted to go. See, if I had more time with Dracula, I would really explore how he became Dracula. Why is he the way he is? And to me, Dracula is love in exile. Dracula is unrequited love. And when you put it out there and you don't get it back, you go bad. And so I want, one day it would be nice to be able to have a 2-hour narrative where I could explore how Dracula became Dracula. But we didn't have that in this movie. So to answer your question, I came in experimenting with the teeth, with the look. That immediately, the external appearance helped inform the internal choices to play the part. But I had it already fixed in my head that I was going to borrow from Christopher Lee and Bancroft and my father, August Coppola, who was a professor as well, as you know. And he was the kind of guy who spoke with a mid-Atlantic accent, and he was always the smartest man in the room. Dracula's been around for over 400 years, so he knows he's smarter than everybody else. He's seen everything. So I kind of had to put that in my body, and that's how I would enter the room, and that's how I prepared.
Hey, Charles, you'll be glad. I have a plan to get me out of your house pronto.
A job is a plan. Is your plan a job?
Drum roll, please. I'm going to be a screenwriter, like you. Okay, I know you think this is just one of my get-rich-quick schemes, but I'm doing it right this time. I'm taking a 3-day seminar, and it's only $500.
Screenwriting seminars are bullshit.
In theory, I agree with you, but this one's different. This one's highly regarded in the industry.
No, don't say industry.
I'm sorry, I forgot. Charles, this guy knows screenwriting. People come from all over to study with him. I'll pay you back, buddy, just as soon
as I... Let me explain something to you.
Okay.
Anybody who says he's got the answer is going to attract desperate people, be it in the world of religion...
I just need to lie down while you explain this to me. Sorry, I apologize. Okay, go ahead. Sorry. Okay, go.
There are no rules, Donald. And anybody who says there are
Not rules. Principles. McKee writes that a rule says you must do it this way. A principle says this works and has through all remembered time.
What do you normally do during makeup time when you're in the chair?
Well, to the frustration of my makeup artists, and I'm sure whoever's else in the trailer, I'm running lines. I'm just running them out. I'm doing my monologues. What doesn't matter who's there, or I'm putting it on my cell phone and playing it back and looking at what I just did. Is that working? Is this working? I'm just rehearsing the whole time. I'm always in the headspace of the character. Not that I'm a method actor per se, but I'm always checking it. I'm always looking at, I'm open to looking at my surroundings when I take a character on to filter it through, well, how does that character see the world? So even though I'm still Nicholas, I'm always aware that I'm playing a part in this movie. So I'm deep in thought the whole time, and I'm always rehearsing.
You've had a glorious career, worked with the best of the best, and during that time, many of your co-stars have retired. Others have disappeared for years, finding it hard to land a good role. But you've stayed relevant, at times reinventing, rebranding. share with us your secret for longevity?
Wow, that's a great question. And I just stayed interested. And the older you get, the harder it is to remain interested. But I stayed interested. And also acting was a necessity for me. In many ways, it's my guardian angel. It's what took whatever destructive energy I may have taken on through life experience and alchemically converted it, transmuted it into something productive, constructive. It is not per se therapy, but it is a way of purging. And if it's a necessity, what else can you do? You know, I'm not going to stop. Even if there are dry spells, because I am freelance, I'm a hired hand. Even if there are dry spells, I have to work, whatever the format, because I want to keep my instrument, meaning my body, my voice, my imagination in tune, my memory in tune. So I don't have a problem if the studio doesn't call and there's a video on demand movie, which, by the way, to me, anyone that uses the word straight to video now is a dinosaur. Everything is streaming. We're streaming all the time. I think we can do both. But I'll go. I'll do it because it's more important to me that I get back on the court, that I stay in the fray, that I keep practicing.
While there have been almost unparalleled highs in your career, you've also faced some criticism at times. How have you healed yourself and bounced back?
Well, the criticism is always interesting, isn't it? I mean, it's like Isidore Ducasse wrote a book called Poesies, and in that book he put forth the notion that, I don't know if I entirely agree with him, but the critic is more important than the work of art itself, because the artist is looking for a response and the critic is the mirror that provides the response. Listen, I have enough rhino skin to know, to read reviews and to either agree with them or not agree with them, but it's always interesting to hear the response and what you can do with that response and learn from it. But I never gave up. I never lost hope. Like, one of the reasons why I'm here with all of you is I've been doing it since I was 15, so 45 years now, and I've seen a lot of changes in the industry, but I never lost hope that a young person from a younger generation would remember me. Like, I've been there in their lives since they were born, you know, looking on the TV like the way I was with Jerry Lewis or Charles Bronson or Marlon Brando. And I knew that that young person would remember this, the first 15 years or whatever, or what I meant in this character, that movie meant to them growing up, and that I would get a phone call. And that happened with Michael Cernowski and Pig. You know, that was a dry period for me, but he came to me with his script, Pig, and he knew I could play his part, Rob. So I called him Archangel Michael, because he really pulled me out of the, you know, I guess what some people in the industry would call the boneyard. But that was because he remembered me, and he remembered what I could do. So I never lost faith in that. I never lost faith that a young filmmaker, he or she, would call me, and there would be a new spark. And I still have that.
What was going to be your signature dish?
Liver scotch eggs with a honey curry mustard.
They're not real. You get that, right? None of it is real. The critics aren't real. The customers aren't real. Because this isn't real. You aren't real.
Okay.
Derek, why do you care about these people? They don't care about you. None of them. They don't even know you. Because you haven't shown them. Every day you'll wake up and there'll be less of you. You live your life for them and they don't even see you. You don't even see yourself. We don't get a lot of things to really care about.
I'm going to quote Ethan Hawke here. Nicolas Cage is the only actor since Marlon Brando that's actually done anything new with the art of acting. Let's talk about the new for a moment. What would you like to accomplish that you haven't already accomplished?
Well, I was mentioning it last night. First of all, that was very nice of Ethan. But when I was talking about groundbreaking, we were talking about groundbreaking. That was what the words were for the evening. I think part of groundbreaking is really to be informed with what's been done and then try to find a way to move forward with that. What can you learn from that? And then take that guidance from the previous movies and the previous performances and then, you know, almost bend it to fit your vision. And so I can't really take credit for that. You know, long before I was going, I'm Nick, I can't engage, there's James Cagney going, top of the world, Mom, at White Heat. You know, so I knew what worked. And so that's why watching movies is so important, because you can see what works. It doesn't matter if this generation doesn't know who Edward G. Robinson is, or doesn't know who Humphrey Bogart is, or doesn't know who James Cagney is. The point is, the moves they did on camera worked, and the vocal intonations and their deliveries worked. So if you can cherry pick some of that, like I did with Spider-Man Noir, it's going to land anyway, because it works. It doesn't matter if you don't know the actors I'm calling from, it still works. As I said in the beginning, I'm a student, so I'm you. I want to do probably what you all want to do. I right now, I want to find a way where I can DIY, where I can do it yourself, and I have to have the commitment and I have to have the follow through. The second most important thing on your path is follow through. The first most important thing is your imagination. Number two is follow through. So if you don't have follow through, you're not going to make it. I have to now call upon myself to have follow through to, you know, whatever it is, go to some friends, what have you, and start a fund. And let's say we call it $50,000, and I want to buy the cameras, and they can be digital, and I'll get back to digital. That's important. I want to talk to you about that. And I want to write the script myself. My neighbor was Jerry Lewis of The Great Nutty Professor of 1964, which was what I was watching as a child and what made me partially want to be an actor. And I have to write my script. To be the total filmmaker, you need to act, direct, produce, compose, and you know, release it. And I want to do that. Like Chaplin did that, Lewis did that. Today we have Jim Cummings out of New Orleans. He's doing that. That's the next step. And so you own it, and then you put it out there yourself. I think that's freedom. That's total freedom, and you guys can do that.
So why are you a drunk?
Why am I drunk? Is that really what you want to ask me?
Yes.
Well, then this is our first date, or our last. Until now, I wasn't sure it was either.
First. It's our first. I just want to know. Why are you killing yourself?
Interesting choice of words. I don't remember. I just know that I want to.
Are you saying that your drinking is a way to kill yourself?
Or killing myself is a way to drink.
Very clever.
Can I have another one, please? Blush on your cheek whenever I speak tells me that you are my own.
So for me, when I make a movie, they're all my children. The ones that work, the ones that don't work are all my children. So it's important, like with the birth of a child, to witness. And I'll watch the movie one time. and then I let it go because I got to move forward. I don't want to look back. Sometimes, rarely, but sometimes, excuse me, I will look at early work if it is important to what I'm doing now. Unbearable Weight of Massive Talent, because we were recalling some scenes from like Face Off and Leaving Las Vegas and Gone 60 Seconds, didn't make it in the movie. But anyway, I wanted to see what I had done in those pictures and to transmogrify them in sort of like a German expressionistic Cabinet of Dr. Caligari manner of acting. They left all that on the table. The studio didn't want it, but it was good stuff. I hope Tom Gormican does something with it, the director, at some point. But yeah, if there's a reason to look at it, then I'll do it. Otherwise, let it go, move forward.
Let's take a couple of questions from the audience. Barry, go ahead.
Okay, hello. My name is Barry Gordon. I'm the chair of the film department here at Miami-Dade College. And many of our students are in the audience.
Fantastic.
You touched on this a little bit when you were talking, but if you were to give them some words of wisdom, some advice or a secret to get into this oftentimes difficult industry to enter, what would that be?
Right. So I don't see myself as someone who gives advice unless you ask me. But I think fundamentally, don't listen to no and don't listen to can't. It's as simple as that. Yeah, and you know what I'm talking about, right? That's why. So listen, that has to come from you. You're the only one that can say no mas. You're the only one who said, I've had enough. I don't want to do this anymore. And by the way, I had that moment. I had gone on audition in Hollywood, audition, rejected. People looking, bad producers looking at their nails while I'm reading, not interested in anything I was doing. And I was sort of, and I'd already done a few movies, but it was like, I got sick. I came down with an illness and I was in the hospital and I was saying to myself, you know what? I'm only gonna do one more time. I'm gonna try. And if it doesn't work, I had plan B. It's good to have a plan B. And plan B, because I like to read and I like Melville and Conrad, I was going, well, okay, I'm not going to be an actor, but maybe I can be a writer and I'm going to get on a boat. I don't know if it's going to be a fishing boat or a merchant marine. I'm just going to write down my experiences. That was plan B. It could have also been interesting.
Colin, go ahead.
Hi.
Never thought I'd get this chance. Feels like Comic-Con.
Hi, Colin. Good name.
I grew up in the early 2000s, so I definitely remember a lot of your work. So you've done quite a few superhero movies. I remember Ghost Rider, Kick-Ass, and Spider-Noir. So
right.
What was it like doing superhero movies in the pre to early MCU era, and how's that compared to now? And if you want to throw in a bit about Spider-Verse too, I'd love that.
Well, I enjoy, as you, it's obvious, I grew up in between the Huxley and the Melville and the Kafka. I was looking at covers of the Hulk from the 70s, and I always liked the monsters. Ghost Rider and the Hulk were my favorite characters. I thought they were complicated. I thought they were dramatic. But I had a lot of fun making those movies before the so-called MCU and that machine occurred, and I liked the freedom that we had to make those movies. Spider-Man, Spider-Verse, you know, they didn't call me to be in the sequel, the animated sequel, but I said, you know, that's fine, but apparently they want to bring the character back for the third installment, so we'll see what happens.
All right, over here, let's take a question.
Hi, Nicholas. I'm Jacqueline Jales, a student here from Miami-Dade College, but I'm also a Brazilian filmmaker. And I was wondering, what do you think about the foreign movies productions outside of Hollywood? And if you would consider to do it all project in partnership with Brazilians or any other foreign talents?
Absolutely. Now,
and with me.
Yeah. Well, yeah, send me a script, Mike Nylon. Listen, you know, I'm a big believer in genus loci, which is Latin for the genie of the place. So if I get a phone call from Thailand, or I get a phone call from Brazil, or I get a phone call from, you know, Italy or Spain or wherever it may be, automatically that's a big reason to do the movie, because I want to absorb the energy of the location, because it does, as esoteric and mysterious as that sounds, it does inform performance. You know, a lot of people ask me, why do you live in Las Vegas? And one of my answers is, well, I made six movies here and they were all really good, so something's working. You know, so yeah, if you have something and you want to shoot in Brazil, that's interesting.
All right. Yeah, Brazil is the best energy in the world.
I have to go. I have to go. It's been, I haven't been yet. It's one of the places that I have to go, because the literature is magnificent, the movies are magnificent, the energy is magnificent. Everything I've heard about it, and this is coming from very high up, from people in the academic realm, saying this is where it's at. And I think, by the way, Miami is also where it's at. I think you've got something going on here. Yeah. And Gianni Versace knew that, right?
Let's take a question from over here, please.
Hey, Nicholas. So first off, I want to thank you so much for coming here and to be with all of us. I loved you in The Knowing, man. That was my favorite movie when I was little.
Which one?
The Knowing.
Oh, right. Oh, gosh. You know, I never hear about that one. Thank you for that.
That was like, when I was little, that was the movie that I would constantly watch with my family. My mom loves you. You know,
oh,
that little
thank
scene, you me, together forever.
Well, very nice. So, that's what I'm talking about. See that? That's the memory. You grow up and make a movie, then you call me.
Yeah, appreciate it. All right. So my question to ask you is, in your whole career, what was the toughest performance you ever had to do?
Playing myself in Unbearable Weight of Massive Talent. That was a high-risk movie for me, because it could have gone either way. It was a real high-wire act.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah, well, listen, I said at the start that I was going to ask you questions, and I forgot to do that, because I want to learn something here. So I'm going to start with you. What do you want to see happen with movies?
I think I would want to start seeing what's called a lot more, first off, a lot more representation for a lot more specific type of cultures around there. And two, I think a lot more independent story-wise, like a lot more individual, more personal stories out there. Not like,
oh, man, I agree with you 100% on both fronts. I totally agree. I'll remember that.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Nick, as an actor, your body is your instrument. You right. talked a little bit about that. How right. do you keep it tuned?
Working. Working keeps the instrument fluid and present. It keeps the memory going. You have to memorize mountains of dialogue. You have to be comfortable with your voice coming out of your body. You have to be comfortable with designing characters. Reading. Watching movies. You see, I said imagination is your most important element in this path that we're all on. And you have to, it's like weightlifting for your mind. You have to read and you have to watch movies. You gotta just pick a director and say, let's see what Chantel Ackerman's all about. And sit through the movie and learn everything that person did. Or Ingmar Bergman, I'm going to watch Persona. I'm going to watch The Virgin Spring. I'm going to watch Wild Strawberries. And you just download it all into your body. Or Kurosawa or Coppola or Kubrick. Get it all in your body and then think about what that experience was for you. And then see what you can do, what you learn from that, and bend it into your own vision. That's how you stay fresh.
Over here, go ahead.
Good morning, Mr. Cage.
Good morning.
I'm Havana Durango. I'm a student here at MDC. I was wondering, well, I feel really confident in saying that most of the people in this room, we work behind camera, so like grip and electric, makeup, props, set deck. So I was wondering, apart from acting, which department was most interesting to you?
I think art direction is really key, you know. You can have the greatest cinematographer in the world, but if they don't have something to photograph, it's not going to work. I think art direction would be the department that I think provides great creativity, even going so far back as the silent movie Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. They didn't have any money, so they were building sets out of cardboard. So they had to come up with this abstract, bizarre, dreamlike set art direction to make up for the fact that they had no money. It's amazing what you can do when you run out of money, because you got to be inventive, you know? Now I'm going to ask you a question. What do you want to see happen with movies?
It's going to be a little controversial, but I feel like in the past few years, a lot of the things that have come out of Hollywood are a little bit like recycled, in my opinion. But I feel really proud of a lot of the people in this room, and I feel a lot of hope for a lot of new things that are coming out. So
this is beautiful. It's happening here, right? It's happening here, and everything both of you just said is exactly what I'm feeling. It's like we got to get back to original stories. You know, let's stop recycling, because you know why they're doing it. It's the almighty dollar, and they want to have a degree of certainty, and they're putting tons of money in it, and it's making money, but they keep doing what they have a certainty about, that they don't have to take too much risk, which is why I'll never stop making small independent movies, because that's where you can take the risk.
Over here, where's your question?
Hello, my name is Giovanni Piard. I have three quick questions for you. The first one is, as an actor, what would you say makes a good film director? Or what attributes and qualities do they have?
Okay. That's a good question. So Elia Kazan wrote a book, A Life, and in that book he said it's much of it is about don't fix what isn't broken. And that means a lot to an actor. When you come in, you're already prepared and you really know the character. The last thing you want is a director coming in, even before you've heard action, he starts micromanaging your character. And it's like, I always say, look, give me two takes. And then if you want to adjust, sculpt, I like that word, then come in and give me some notes. I mean, you have to be collaborative. You've got to work with your director. It's their vision. It would be foolish not to, because they're ultimately going to put the movie together. If you stick out like a sore thumb, it's not going to work. So, but, you know, just find a director that, even if they're young, like Michael Cernowski, he was confident. You have to find a director, he or she, who is confident enough to trust their actors. Because if they start micromanaging you, you're going to cave in. And you're going to lose that flower of creativity where you feel confident, where you feel like you can play this part.
Okay. The second other question is...
Well, keep it to two then.
Okay. Okay, if that's the case, I'm going to go to my third one. With you acting and taking place in majority of the world stage, do you ever feel like you can't ever just be yourself? Like even right now as you're on stage, you're being yourself, but like instead of being yourself, you're playing yourself, more of a caricature. Do you find that place or that people that allows you to relax and just be you and not play you?
Well, first of all, I am myself right now. So there's that. I'm not playing myself. But second of all, no. I don't, you know, even though I'm always myself in whatever season of myself I'm in, I don't think I can totally relax because someone's going to say something or record something or photograph something. So I am... But listen, I've been doing this since I was 15. So I've been doing this longer... I've been on camera longer than I was before I was on camera, so it's been 45 years, and it's become sort of a part of my DNA. So, but I assure you, I'm giving you myself. Now, Joe, what do you want to see happen with movies?
So, with movies nowadays, like, I like watching them, but then when I see like stuff about like, oh, this character, you know, black, gay, or whatever, it's not necessarily a bad thing. Representation is not a bad thing. But when you're making forced representation, it detracts me from the movie. Unless that's the point of the movie, why make it in the first place? Like, if you're gonna make a movie about it, the point is, if you wanna make it or bring attention to it. The point is, don't bring attention to it by then for bring attention to it. Because if you make a point, you're like, oh, they're poor people. You're then just adding at they're poor. If you just add that they're people and just add that part of the movie without trying to emphasize that or make it the purpose of it, unless it's satirical in that nature, then don't do that. Just add
this
it in.
This is brilliant. See, I wish all of you were running Hollywood. I really wish you guys were studio heads and you were calling the shots. This is why I came here. I'm learning something. This is beautiful. Everything you're saying is exactly what I'm thinking too. We are in sync. You know, I remember once I was with Harry Dean Stanton and he came over for dinner and Marlon came up and I, you know, I said, you know, because I was kind of sad about what happened with his daughter and his son, and I just said, it's so tragic. And then Harry Dean said, hey, no, don't label it. It's not, you're going to label it now, Nick? It's not tragic. It just is. It just is. And I think what Joe is saying is make a movie, it just is. You don't have to point it out for political reasons or you're trying to get an Oscar or this is what we're doing now because, you know, just tell the story. It just is.
Peter Falk adored John Cassavetes. He was the most fertile man I ever met. There wasn't a copycat bone in his body, he said. Is there a filmmaker you feel equally passionate about?
John's a good one, wow. And I knew Peter. We did Next together. I had grown up watching him as Columbo and A Woman Under the Influence. I was an enormous fan. I had a few TV actors that were actors that were big on TV when I was a kid, and he was one of them. But I would say that for me, the personal movies, Alia Kazam, because his movies are the reason I became an actor, because I discovered the power of film performance with Ys Davidian and James Dean's Nervous Breakdown. Federico Fellini, because he is so free with the camera and with his art direction and his score with Nino Rota that I love movies that have a true personality and original vision that you know right away this is a Fellini movie. Kurosawa, Bergman. I mean, it just goes on and on. And you know what? I can't stand these lists. I just can't stand, like, Sight and Sound came out with this list about the greatest directors of all time. And, you know, David Lynch is number 7. And I like David. We all know David's really good. But I mean, like, what? Kurosawa is 13 and Bergman is 20. I mean, you can't do it like that. It's more like categories. They all have equal value. It's just different tastes, you know?
So we're going to take one final question here, and then I'll have a final question for you.
Yeah, sure.
Hi, my name is Lowell Williams. I'm a professor here in the theater department. You've been talking mainly about film. I mainly teach actors for the stage. Any comments about stage acting? Have you ever been on stage? And one other question, have you ever wanted to do anything else but acting?
Can I say one quick thing? Lowell, by the way, you were a professor of mine at UM. So just wanted to give you a shout out.
Well, the stage is daunting. It's something I fear to get on the boards. I did it in high school and I had some good results, but my interest was predominantly or totally film. And, you know, some of my heroes like Jack Nicholson never made it on the stage, but I do think, because I believe that the thing you fear within reason, as long as you're not hurting yourself or somebody else, is the very thing you should go towards. I do think I should push myself and go towards the stage because I would learn something. And I like the idea of not hearing the word cut. But cinema is also an awesome trial. Many stage actors are nervous to get in front of a camera because the close-up is an awesome trial. If something's going on, you're gonna see it. And if nothing's going on, you're going to see it. And I'm kind of a self-imposed dogma film actor. I have rules for myself, which is that you cannot ever put fake tears in my eyes. You will never, I will get them off the set. You have to have real tears. You have to find some place in your heart that brings them up. It's all got to be authentic and organic. And rehearse the scenes that you're doing as if you were shooting, so the director knows where you're going to go. But I hope that answers some of your questions. Thank you.
So, I've brought my copy of The Glass Menagerie with me, and at the end, there's an essay Tennessee Williams wrote titled The Catastrophe of Success. And there's just a little quick excerpt that I'm going to share with you. It says, "The sort of life that I had previous to this popular success was one that required endurance, a life of crawling and scratching along a sheer surface and holding on tight with raw fingers to every inch of rock higher than the one caught hold of before. But it was a good life because it was the sort of life for which the human organism is created." So, how have you become so comfortable with yourself and your persona that you're able to make movies that are so meta?
Meta?
Yeah, self-referential.
Well, first of all, that movie, Massive Talent, was also parody. I mean, it wasn't entirely reverential. I mean, it was also pretty goofy. Well, who am I to add to Tennessee Williams' thought process? He's one of our America's greatest writers, along with Melville and Poe. I mean, he's a giant, and I need to thank you. I need to read more of his plays and learn. I just don't think I know anything else. You know, it's been, like I said, it's been 45 years. It's in my DNA. It just is.
Thank you so much for so generously sharing your time with us today and for the rawness of your art.
Thank you. And thank you all for answering my questions. Thank you.
Mr. Cage, on behalf of Miami-Dade College students, as you see here, Professor Garcia, thank you. Let me read this appreciation award presented to Academy Award winner Nicolas Cage for your encouraging words that will forever inspire Miami-Dade College to pursue their dreams and reach the stars.
Oh, well, thank you so much. Thank you.
That is a picture of last night with our college president that you took at the film festival.
It looks good. You know what I appreciate most about this? I'm a Miami-Dade speaker, and that's more important to me than an Academy Award winner. So, thank you.